Nikita, has all the participants joined the meeting?
No, the first participant, Anjali Rajkumar, hasn't joined.
No, she has joined. She has joined.
I'm not able to see her. One second.
Okay, then let me start the event now. Good afternoon, respected judge ma'am and our participants. I'm Ashmita Saraya, event coordinator at SamsaCon 2.0, along with my co-host Anjana Shru, Abhishek, and Nikita Prabhakar. Here we are today for a case history presentation, pediatric. Firstly, I would like to introduce our honorable judge, Dr. Professor Kalpana Datta, ma'am.
Yes.
Who is a professor of pediatric, director of Pediatric Center of Excellence in HIV Care, MCK, that is Medical College, Kolkata, member of Technical Resource Group of India for HIV, president of Society of Pediatric Neurology, Bengal, member of Subject Expert Committee in Central Drugs Standard Control Organization. Ma'am, it is such a pleasure to have you here. We are overwhelmed with your presence. Thank you for giving in your precious time for the event. I would like to request you to say a few words addressing the conference and our participants.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone, my dear students. This should be, I think, a wonderful experience to hear from our budding doctors from different parts of the country. And I don't know whether the outside the country, any participants from the other parts of the country? It's totally in Eastern India?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so different part of this.
Yes, ma'am, we have participants from South India. Yes, ma'am. We have participants from Pondicherry, Jipmer. From
okay.
South side, we have participants.
Okay, so it's a I think it will be a wonderful experience to hear from the budding doctors for different issues, very common issues they have chosen, and from the different parts of the region, not only the state and country. And I wish a grand success of your conference.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Next, I would like my co-host Anjana Shu and Nikita to start the event by introducing our participants. Our first participant, Anjali Rajkumar.
Good afternoon, everyone. Coming up first on the platform is Anjali Rajkumar, final year part 2 student from Jipmer Medical College, Pondicherry.
Anjali, are we audible to you? You can start your screen share.
Okay.
Okay, just a sec. I would like to just narrow down the rules once. 5 minutes presentation that will be followed by 10 minutes of cross-questioning by our respected ma'am. Is it all right?
Is my screen visible?
Not yet.
Is my screen visible now?
Not yet. Actually, your connection is not very stable. Just check your connection.
Shall I switch to my phone then? I think.
All right.
Can I switch to my phone?
Yeah. Try it once.
Yeah.
If you want, then I can even share your share the screen for her presentation, if that is required.
I'll just enter in Zoom.
You just try once. If everything goes well, then good.
Can you give me 1 minute? I'll just check with this.
You just click the share screen.
Yeah,
first you save your the case report on the desktop. If you have some slides, no, keep it ready on the desktop, then you share your screen, then you will click that part on the desktop and it will be visible. I think you have to keep it on the desktop.
Is it visible now? Yes, it's visible.
Yeah. Just click your yes. Make it slideshow mode. Okay.
Shall I start, ma'am?
Yes.
Respected judges and my dear friends, I'm Anjali Rajkumar from JIPMA. I'm going to present a case of cyanotic heart disease today. Master Shabrish, a three-month-old male who was born on 4-6-2020, second born in the family, hailing from Kadalur and belonging to modified BJ Prasad class 4, with informant being mother and good reliability, presented with the chief complaints of breathlessness, bluish extremities and mouth with uprolling of eyeballs, a single episode for 15 minutes 3 days back, and difficulty in sucking continuously for more than 3 to 5 minutes for 3 days. History of present illness. The infant was apparently asymptomatic 3 days ago when he got up at 6 a.m. and was crying for feeds for some time. Soon, the baby developed breathlessness. Lips and palms turned blue. In 1 to 2 minutes, he lost his consciousness with uprolling of eyeballs. The infant was taken to a private hospital where IV medications and oxygen were given. Drowsiness improved within an hour, but baby wasn't feeding actively and hence got referred to JIPMA. After coming to JIPMA, the infant is receiving some oral drugs, not receiving oxygen, accepting breastfeeding, but not sucking the breast for 3 to 4 minutes. There's no sweating of forehead while feeding, and there was mild blueness of lips, tongue, mouth, fingers, and toes persisting. There's no history of any fever, cough, cold, loose stools, or aspiration. Past history, the mother refuses any past history of similar bluish discoloration of lips, fingers, or toes anytime since birth. Coming to antenatal history, it was a spontaneous conception out of non-consanguineous marriage. The mother was booked and immunized with no significant drug intake history or infection history with no deranged sugar values during antenatal period. Natal and postnatal history. The baby was born by spontaneous vaginal delivery at term gestation at Kadalu GH with a normal birth weight, cried immediately after birth, was started on breastfeeds within half an hour of birth. There was a history of NICU stay for 2 days in view of workup for the antenatally detected congenital heart disease. The baby was left for a follow-up at 3 months of life. The baby was immunized up to date. Nutritionally was exclusively breastfed, developmentally normal, and the family history had no history of any congenital cardiovascular diseases. The socioeconomic history revealed that the baby came from a family of 6 members who lived in 2 rooms and hence overcrowding was present, and they belonged to class 4. Coming to examination, on general examination, the baby was conscious and alert, playful and active. Central cyanosis and grade 1 clubbing were present and conjunctiva appears to be suffused. On head to toe examination, the head shape appeared to be normal with open anterior fontanelle, pulsatile and non-bulging. No obvious facial dysmorphism was seen. Vitals, the baby was afebrile with a pulse rate of 120 per minute, regular in rhythm, normal in volume and character. No radioradial or radiofemoral delay. All peripheral pulses were palpable. The respiratory rate was 40 per minute. SpO2 was 82% in the right upper limb and 83% in the right lower limb with a capillary filling time of 2 seconds and blood pressure of 96/66 millimeters of mercury in the right upper limb and 94/60 millimeters of mercury in the right lower limb. Anthropometrically, the baby was found to be severely undernourished. Stunting and microcephaly were also present. Coming to systemic examination, cardiovascular system. On inspection, the chest wall appeared to be symmetrical and normal with no precordial bulge or any visible pulsations. Apical impulse was not visualized and JVP was not elevated. On palpation, the apex beat was palpable along the left fourth intercostal space, 1 centimeter lateral to the midclavicular line, normal in character. On auscultation, S1 was heard normally, S2 was single and loud, and ejection systolic murmur of grade 3 heard over third and fourth left intercostal space, best heard with diaphragm of stethoscope. Other systems were examined and found to be normal. Summary, a 3-month-old developmentally normal male infant, second born out of non-consanguineous marriage, belonging to lower middle class with antenatally detected congenital heart disease, who was probably normal until 3 days prior to the hospital admission when he developed breathlessness, bluish extremities, and mouth with uprolling of eyes. On examination, the infant was found to have suffused conjunctiva with central cyanosis and grade 1 clubbing. The blood pressure was found to differ by 2/6 millimeters of mercury between the upper limb and lower limb. And anthropometrically, the baby was having severe undernutrition, stunting, and microcephaly. On auscultation, a short systolic murmur of grade 3 was heard over the third and fourth intercostal space. So my provisional diagnosis in this case would be, this is a case of cyanotic congenital heart disease with reduced pulmonary blood flow, most probably a tetralogy of Fallot case with no evidence of congestive cardiac failure, pulmonary hypertension, or infective endocarditis with failure to thrive. And I would first do a chest X-ray in this patient, and then followed by an ECG and echocardiography, after which I'll initiate the treatment. Thank you.
Okay, Anjali, it's a nice presentation and case, nicely chosen case. The first of all, you tell me, what are the features which led you to think this is a heart disease, and that too also congenital heart disease? What are the factors? Why did you say it's a heart disease?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, if you say this chief complaints of the patient is coming with a...
Tell me the points.
Yes, ma'am. Patient is coming with breathlessness, bluish extremities. So breathlessness, we can go for CVS or RS. So we can localize it to two systems thereby. And the bluish extremities classically points towards cardiovascular system. And the uprolling of eyeballs is probably an indication of the hypoxemic seizures which occurred in the patient. And there is difficulty in sucking continuously. That is also indicative of fatigue and dyspnea due to cardiovascular disease, ma'am. So by these symptoms, I can come to the conclusion that patient is probably having a heart disease. And since he is only 3 months, it's probably a congenital heart disease.
Okay. So uprolling of eyes can have any other causes of uprolling of eyes in this particular age group? You said it may be due to the hypoxic drive. What is could it be? It could be something else. May not be due to hypoxic drive. It's something else. Could it be convulsion?
Yes, ma'am. Hypoxemic seizures.
So how can you differentiate between the cyanotic events leading to convulsion or neurological events leading to convulsion? What do you think? It is a breath holding spell or cyanotic spell or any anoxic, any convulsion? Can you differentiate between three?
Yes, ma'am. In this patient, we can classically see other features of cyanosis also.
In case of convulsion, you will get the cyanosis at the end, not in the beginning. Huh?
Yes.
Unless the respiratory center is compromised. So yes, as there is a beginning of the convulsion, cyanosis is there, so it is cyanotic spell. Huh? Due to the hypoxic drive. Next, you said
in... Yes, ma'am. If it was a CNS case, then probably there will be other evidence of...
Sequence of events of the history in case of convulsion, you have to ask the very, very important sequence of event, whether sinus is at the beginning of the convulsion uprolling or at the end of the uprolling, whether what is the condition of the respiratory rate. There are different parameters. What is this? Eyes are, as you said, uprolling, sometime maybe staring, sometime maybe closed. So for the... These are the factors by which you can differentiate between different type of convulsion of different etiology. But you said there is no radiofemoral and radial delay. Can you palpate the radial artery in 3 months old child?
Ma'am, we can palpate, but it won't be localized just like adults.
Yeah. In newborn and infants, it is the brachial artery, huh? Not radial artery. Oh, next, neck vein. Do you see the neck vein in it? Usually, don't get the neck vein in infants.
No, ma'am. JVP is not.
Why?
Because, ma'am, for JVP, 3 centimeters is the normal. Above that is known as raised JVP, but infants, the neck length of the neck is too small to determine whether JVP is raised or not.
Yes, the short neck.
Short neck.
Okay, so next you said the X-ray. In X-ray, you said the boot-shaped heart.
Yes, ma'am.
What do you mean by boot-shaped heart?
Ma'am, boot-shaped heart is basically, there's an upturning of the apex due to right ventricular hypertrophy. This leads to the boot shape on X-ray.
Okay, anything else? And if there's a left ventricular hypertrophy, what could have been the apex beat? Apex, which side? If left ventricular hypertrophy?
It would be outward and downward.
Okay, good. And what will be the, what is the lung field? Whether it's oligemic and hyperemic in your case?
It is oligemic, ma'am.
Why there's oligemic here, oligemia?
Because here there is an obstruction to the pulmonary circulation. So there will be pulmonary hypoplasia associated and there will be pulmonary oligemia on chest x-ray.
Okay. So your diagnosis was, it is a tetralogy of Fallot's?
Yes, ma'am.
So what are the components of tetralogy of Fallot's?
And the most important component is the pulmonary infundibular stenosis, and which is associated with a non-restrictive VST. And there will also be a right ventricular hypertrophy, which occurs secondary to this. And in 25% of cases, we can see an overriding of aorta also.
So these four components, that's why it is called tetralogy of Fallot.
Yes.
Okay. So what will be the ECG finding?
Ma'am, ECG, five classical signs are seen. The boot-shaped heart with upturning of apex, pulmonary oligemia, then the aortic, there will be a concavity at the where the aortic root.
You are talking about
echo? Chest x-ray, ma'am.
Chest x-ray and echo, but I'm asking ECG. In ECG, what will you get? You have answered.
Okay. ECG, what will you get in ECG, the ECG? There will be, ma'am, ECG will get a right axis deviation. Right axis deviation.
Okay. So, what are the complications you might encounter in case of tetralogy of Fallot's? You have to look for that.
There can be complications like the most risk factor complication is a brain abscess in this patients. Then we can have polycythemia, which is basically a compensatory mechanism, but polycythemia will predispose the patient to thromboembolisms. Then there can be anemia. The patient will have
polycythemia deficiency. So why there will be iron deficiency anemia? It is as polycythemia is there.
Yes. But it is not, there was a hypoxemia which led to the compensatory polycythemia, but still patient's pulmonary circulation is severely impaired. So there still will be iron deficiency anemia persisting.
Okay, so how do you diagnose iron deficiency anemia in a polycythemic cyanotic child? Can you diagnose by? What will you see?
Only by iron studies we can.
It's not done in all the places. Any other thing in a smear? In blood smear, what will you get? In case of iron deficiency anemia, what type of anemia it is? If you go through the RBC indices? You are answering nicely.
Ma'am, MCV.
What will be the type of anemia in iron deficiency?
It is a microcytic hypochromic anemia.
Yes, so by seeing that, you can see there, you can tell it is a iron deficiency. And you said brain abscess. Can you tell me if the brain abscess and thrombosis is the age group, which is in younger age, which is in the older age?
Brain abscess is common in the elder age group, 5 years almost, that age only.
And cerebral thrombosis?
Thrombosis, also it is around 5 years, say 6 years. That is why we don't do CT MRI right now, because we don't have these risks right now, ma'am.
Okay. So, how will you manage the spell?
Ma'am, if this patient should be immediately taken up for treatment of the cyanotic spell. So, first, we should start the patient on oxygen, and then we'll give IV morphine, 2 milligram per kg body dose, which will cause depression of the respiratory center. We can give propranolol, again 1 mg per kg, so that there will be dilatation of the heart, as well as there will be peripheral vasoconstriction. And then we can ask the patient, we can do knee chest position, wherein we'll reduce the venous return to the heart, as well as increase the systemic vascular resistance. So after controlling these symptoms, we can put the patient on propranolol to prevent further cyanotic spells. And if the patient's condition is good, surgically compatible, we'll immediately go for a shunting procedure, because the patient has one of the indications for the shunting, that is present coming with symptoms at an early age, such as 3 months of age. So on taking up a shunting, we can do a Blalock Tosic shunt. Modified Blalock Tosic shunt is performed using Gore-Tex, wherein we'll form a shunt between the subclavian artery and the pulmonary artery, so that we'll improve the pulmonary circulation in this patient.
Okay, so you will go for the corrective surgery.
Yes, okay. After so one year.
Okay, so sometimes there is a confusion whether it is a cyanosis is because of respiratory origin or cardiac origin. In some cases, huh? So what is hypoxia test? What is that hypoxia test? What do you know? How do you differentiate with respiratory and cardiac cyanosis in newborn? Do you know?
Well, respiratory and cardiac cyanosis in newborn, if we give oxygen, respiratory cyanosis will improve, but cardiovascular cyanosis won't improve.
There will be some improvement. Is there any percentage? Okay. One set of the percentage. Okay. Then, I'll give a condition that this cyanosis gradually improves for a few times and few 2 to 3 years, then Yeagans develop breathlessness and their sinuses gradually decrease. What conditions is going to develop?
Ma'am, pardon me.
If you won't take the corrective surgery, in case of tetralogy fallot, cyanotic child gradually improves and the sinuses gradually decrease and they develop dyspnea on exertion. They will have a respiratory distress and all, but there is a decrease. What condition he is going to develop?
Congestive cardiac failure, ma'am.
No, this is why there is a cyanosis decreased?
Ma'am, cyanosis is decreased because we have corrected the pulmonary circulation, but since we have done the corrective surgery, there's a risk of pulmonary regurgitation. Okay. And hence this will lead to complications.
Okay. Now tell me, what is the how will you explain the prognosis to the parents? What will you say? They will ask if they with the second. I want to take the second baby. What will be the fate of this baby? All those things.
Ma'am, if the first baby is, we'll say that this baby has, though we have done the corrective surgery, there are serious comorbidities associated with it, and hence their life, quality of life will be poor. And if you're going for a second baby, if the first baby is having a congenital heart disease, there's 25% increased chances that the second baby will also get congenital heart disease. So we'll go for a pedigree charting and go for family planning procedures.
Good. Nicely presented. Thank you. I think it's enough for you. I want to end this session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Anjali Rajkumar. Yeah. Coming next is Heli P. Thakkar. She is a fourth year medical student from Srimati NHL Municipal Medical College. Her topic is fever with rashes.
What is the name of the student?
Ma'am, Haley Thakkar from Srimati NHL Municipal Medical College.
No, name of the student is Srimati Aneja.
My name is Haley Thakkar and I'm from Srimati NHL Municipal Medical College, Ahmedabad.
Okay.
Shall I start my screen sharing?
Yes.
Ma'am, so my first case is a 4-year male child came to hospital with the chief complaints of low-grade fever, painful ulcers in mouth, rashes on the hand and the feet, and also over the buttocks region and around the knee. The past history and the treatment history was negative. The immunization was up to date, and the patient attends the pre-nursery school with a history of similar illness in the other children. On examination, the patient was conscious and the examination was carried out in a room with a good exposure to light. The vital parameters were temperature was 101 degree Fahrenheit. The patient had mild fever. The pulse rate was 110 and the BP was 92 by 64. The examination of skin revealed superficial round ulcers on the tongue and the soft palate region. 3 to 7 mm oval-shaped vesicles with the erythromatous halo on the palms were observed. A few discrete palpable lymph nodes were there. The examination of head, face and neck region appeared normal except few discrete lymph nodes which were enlarged and palpable. No pallor, no cyanosis, clubbing or edema was present. These are the pictures of the patient taken during the clinical examination in the hospital. We can see here the erythromatous maculopapular rash over the hand in the foot regions and which is surrounded by the erythromatous halo. And the enanthem, which are the oral vesicular rash and lesions seen over the buccal mucosa and also over the buttocks region. On examination, the CVS examination was normal. The inspection and palpation and percussion didn't show any finding. The per abdominal and the CNS examination was normal. The diagnosis was carried out on the clinical examination of the patient. The patient had hand, foot and mouth disease. The presentation of hand, foot and mouth disease, it is caused by Coxsackie A16 and the enterovirus 71. The incubation period is 3 to 5 days and it is highly contagious virus. And the prodromal symptoms were fever, sore throat, malaise for 1 to 2 days, exanthem, which are the skin lesions. The progression of the lesions are bright pink macules and papules, which further transform into painful vesicles with the erythromatous halo and erosion. The enanthem, which are the oral lesions, are erythromatous erosions resembling the aphthous ulcer. The distribution, first it starts in the mouth, that is over the tongue, buccal mucosa and heart palate. Then it later spread to hand and feet. It is very important to differentiate it from chickenpox, because in chickenpox, the distribution would be first on the trunk region, then it spreads to hand and feet. However, in the hand, foot, mouth disease, we have first the lesions over the hand and feet, and less commonly the buttocks and the knee are involved. The prognosis, it is very important to detect the prognosis in hand, foot, mouth disease. It is caused by Coxsackie A16 and enterovirus 71. Coxsackie A16 has a good prognosis, whereas the enterovirus 71 has bad prognosis and it can lead to aseptic meningitis and encephalitis in the patients. Treatment is supportive since it is a viral infection. We have to provide the antipyretic drugs and analgesic drugs. My second case is the 5-year-old male patient came to the hospital with the chief complaints of cough, sore throat, fever, and red eyes since 4 days. The past history and the family history was negative. The treatment history, he went to his general practitioner 2 days ago and was prescribed amoxicillin for presumed pharyngitis, and after which he developed a red colored rash on his face and has spread to his trunk. So here the mother was worried that whether the rash and the fever was due to the drug prescribed or it was due to infection. Here the immunization was up to only 6 months of age. And the patient was 5-year-old. The general examination was, patient was conscious and the examination was carried out in good exposure to light. The patient was ill appearing. And the vital parameters were temperature 100 degree Fahrenheit. The pulse rate was 88 and the BP was 94 by 68. The examination of skin revealed morbidiform rash with erythromatous macules and papules. The rash has spread to trunk and extremities. No palpable lymph nodes. Examination of head, face and neck. She had coryxa and conjunctivitis. The lesions have coalesced on the face and neck region. The presence of bluish white dots on with the erythromatous base in the mucosal surface close to molar tooth. No pallor, no cyanosis, clubbing and edema present. This was the picture of the baby seen during the clinical examination. The picture shows the baby has a red eye and the rash is seen, erythromatous maculopapular rash seen over the face, facial region and the neck region. We were able to see coplex spot. However, it is very difficult to see coplex spot during the clinical examination since it appears 2 days after the fever. and the patient presented with a rash which appears 4 days after the fever. But we were lucky that we observed a coplex spot over the buccal mucosa. And the systemic examination, CVS, per abdominal, and the CNS examination was completely normal. And the diagnosis on based upon clinical examination was made, which showed the patient has measles. However, we can carry out the diagnosis via antigen detection, antibody detection, and also we can do viral isolation and RT-PCR. However, the RT-PCR is more preferred since it remains positive for 10 to 14 days after the rash, whereas the viral isolation becomes negative 3 days after the rash. So RT-PCR is more preferred in measles. The presentation of measles, the prodromal symptoms include fever, malaise, conjunctivitis, cough, and coryza. Exanthem and enanthem. Exanthem shows erythromatous macules and papules, which begins on the face, spreads cephalocaudally and centrifugally. And by the third day, the whole body is involved. And the enanthem, which are the coplex spots seen in the prodromal period. The recovery clinical improvement generally begins within the 2 days of appearance of rash, and the rash fades away after 3 to 4 days. Here in measles, we have four major characteristics, 3 C's plus 1 F, that is cough, coryza, conjunctivitis, and fever. The management is generally self-limiting, and supportive treatment is given, antipyretic in the fluid management. In India, malnourishment is a major concern over here, and lack of immunization. So we have to take care of the both that the patient is immunized, and vitamin A is given to the patient during the measles infection. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So both of the cases, rash with a fever.
Yeah.
So what are the other exanthematous rashes with fever? Name a few.
Roseola infantum presents with fever with rash. In roseola infantum, when the rash appears, the fever subsides.
Just so, opposite the measles.
Yes, just opposite to measles. So we can differentiate through
what else?
Rubella appears similar to measles. It starts from post-auricular region, then spread to the face, then upper extremity, then trunk, then lower extremity. But the lesions are less painful, and the fever is also of low grade in rubella compared to measles.
Okay.
And in meningococcemia, the rashes are petechial, and the hemorrhagic rash are present. So we can differentiate it from measles.
So how do you differ? What do you mean by macules and papules?
The macules are the flat lesions which are seen, and the papules are the raised skin lesions which are seen. And it is more commonly seen in measles infection, rubella, then roseola infantum.
How do you differentiate this measles with scarlet fever?
In scarlet fever, we have diffuse erythema with desquamation, and we can feel a sandpaper like rash in the scarlet fever.
And in meningococcal rash, what will be the difference?
The rash would be hemorrhagic and petechial rash, and in measles we find petechial rash, but it is very less common.
In which condition you get petechial rashes in measles when the patient is?
If the patient develop any complications, neurological complications or...
No, I'm asking the hemorrhagic rash in measles. In what condition will get the hemorrhagic rash in a measles patient?
Ma'am, I don't know.
Okay. Continue. Okay. So what are the complications of measles?
In measles, we can find post-infectious pneumonia, which is generally seen in immunocompromised individual. Then we can also see laryngeotracheobronchitis, which is croup. We name it croup. Then also post-infectious encephalitis. It is actually
laryngeotracheobronchitis is bacterial origin or viral origin?
Ma'am, it is viral origin.
So after measles, another viral attack?
Yes, ma'am.
It is the commonest one?
No, ma'am, it is not common.
What else?
We can find post-infectious encephalitis.
Measles virus infect which area? Usually?
Usually respiratory tract, then the reticuloendothelial system, and then the secondary viremia occurs. respiratory.
Which we like respiratory tract and any another tract is very important.
Epithelial regions, it generally
so another affects... another presentation is very common in and that complications are very common. Why we are concerned about the measles infection and we are taking so much of campaign and giving vaccination, why so? How does it cause malnutrition?
Malnutrition, it causes diarrhea in the GI tract, which lead to vitamin A deficiency, and which is a major complication of measles.
So it causes diarrhea, huh?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay,
yes.
What else?
Then post-infectious encephalitis. It is generally immune response to myelin basic protein, which occurs in measles. And also we see subacute sclerosing panencephalitis.
Which is a long-term complication.
Yes, long-term, after 10 to 13 years of measles infection.
What else? Anything? Anything else? Very common. Do you get otitis media?
Yes, ma'am. We get otitis media.
So respiratory, GI, neuro, complications.
Yes.
So how do you prevent measles infection in children? How do you prevent?
We can promote the immunization. In private practice, we get MMR vaccine. However, right now the government is conducting the MR campaign, eradication campaign. We can give the immunization at 9 months of age. Then the first dose of measles vaccine.
So
then
when, the second. Okay, so you are giving the vaccine the 9 months of age, and how long the maternal antibody for measles persists in the children?
Maternal ma'am, it lasts for 6 months of age.
So 6 months of age, it persists up to 6 months, and you are giving the vaccine nine months. Ma'am. So you are exposing the baby for 3 months. That is called.
Yes, ma'am.
And that period, that period is gone? That is called window period.
Window period,
so,
yes.
Yeah, so you're exposing these babies for 3 months. We are not giving vaccine.
Yes.
Okay, the next dose of vaccine after 9 months?
At 15 months of age. Then at 5 years.
Okay, so you do know there's an MR campaign is going on?
Yes, ma'am. Eradication.
What is the MR surveillance program? Can you highlight few points about that? You have read in your PSM, preventive medicine?
Yes, ma'am. It generally focuses on first on the babies of this 9 month to 5 years of age. Then the pregnant women which are non-immunized are generally focused on.
No. MR campaign. The particular criteria to select the something. Have you read through, gone through the MR campaign or MR surveillance program? Like AFP program, you know AFP?
Yes, ma'am.
Acute paralysis program. Whenever any children having sudden onset lower motor paralysis within 60 days, you pick up those, collect stool. Some program, some features, something to collect. Can you highlight anything about that?
No, ma'am.
Very important. You should know each and every doctor should know. Then only can eradicate measles. Others will miss the measles. Because here also in campaign also, you have to take the history of rash in last 3 months. That is also when patient came to you and baby is not having any complaint of rash. But you have to take the history within the last 3 months. If there's a rash, that will also be included in a MR. And you have to inform the IDSP, the infectious disease surveillance center. It's important. Okay, so you said measles and
hand foot,
hand foot mouth disease, and hand foot mouth disease. You said maculopapular.
No, ma'am. It has vascular rash. I
sometimes it may be vascular rash. So it's a common DD. You said chicken
pox. Differential chicken pox.
Yes, very then, common. How will difference with the chicken pox?
In chicken pox, we
when
have in chicken pox, we have polymorphic rash that is very important.
Yes,
and very also the rash first appears on trunk region, and in hand foot mouth disease, it has it first appears on buccal mucosa, then over the extremities, that is on the hand and foot, then less commonly over buttocks and knee region. Trunk is less commonly involved, which is more involved in chickenpox.
Yes, if you do, so you have to take the history very nicely.
Very clearly, yes.
Carefully. So what are the, you said the, how will diagnose HHF, hand foot mouth disease?
It is generally based upon clinical examination. The diagnosis is usually clinical examination.
Yes, we don't go for the viral aspiration.
Viral aspiration, yes.
Okay. So what is, you said the papular, maculars, and how will the difference with papules and plaques? You know, what is plaques or nodules?
Yes, nodules, yeah.
Papular varieties. Would it be drug reaction? How will the difference with drug, even drug also you can have papules and maculars.
Yes, ma'am.
How will the difference with drugs?
We can, we can ask for the treatment history if she has taken any drug, if the patient has taken any drug, and then we can also see the immunization schedule in the case of measles, mumps, rubella.
And itching?
Itching, yes, ma'am.
Very little itching.
And also painful rash appears in the infectious condition.
Okay. I think okay, it's enough. You have already crossed the 10 minutes. Okay, thank you. Thank you for nice
you,
presentation
ma'am.
And nice explanation. Thank you.
Thank you,
all
thank you ma'am.
Thank you, Heli. Our last participant is Mrinalini Devi. She's a fourth year medical student from GKV, Government Villupuram Medical College and Hospital. I would request her to start her presentation.
Yes, you are audible. Just start your screen share, Mrinalini.
Is my screen visible, ma'am?
Yes, it is.
Are my slides changing, ma'am?
Okay. You can start now.
Good evening to one and all present here. I'm Mrinalini Devi from Government Villupuram Medical College, here to present a case of...
Hello, your voice is not clear. Hello. Mrinalini, your voice is not clear. You come to the mic. Bring your mic towards...
Now am I audible, ma'am?
Make it a slideshow.
Is it visible now, ma'am? Is my voice clear, ma'am?
Yes. Okay.
Can I start now? A pleasant good evening to one and all present here. I'm Mrinalini Devi from Government Villupuram Medical College, here to present the case of pallor with hepatomegaly. 11-year-old female child, previously diagnosed with a hemolytic anemia, was brought by her mother, belongs to socioeconomic class 4, came to hospital with chief complaints of easy fatigability for the past 3 months. No, ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, Mrinalini, you are audible. Your voice is not that clear, so it will be better if you go a bit slow.
How am I audible, ma'am? Can I continue, ma'am?
Yes, yes. Continue.
Diagnosed with a hemolytic anemia at the age of 5 months, she came with chief complaints of easy fatigability for the past 3 months on doing her day-to-day activities, which was relieved by taking rest. She had history of breathlessness for the past 3 months. There was no history of yellowish discoloration of the eyes or dark-colored urine, or there's no history of eating mud or dirt. There's no history of worms in stools, no history of any delayed milestones, no history of constipation, intolerance to cold, excessive gain of weight in spite of good appetite. The patient was apparently normal till the age of 5 months, when she developed pallor, difficulty in breathing, decreased urine output, and abdominal distension, which lasted for 4 days, for which a general physician was consulted. The patient was referred to Jipmer, and on further evaluation, she was diagnosed with a hemolytic anemia. The patient has been instructed to be on regular follow-up and blood transfusions every month. this history of recurrent hospitalization for the blood transfusion. The blood transfusion was done every 3 months for the first 2 years, after which it was done monthly. There was no recent change in the transfusion schedule, and splenectomy was done at the age of 5 years. The patient is currently on tablet deferiprone, 1000 mg BD, folic acid, 1 mg OD, and penicillin prophylaxis. The patient has been on chelated therapy for the past 8 years, and she is also HIV positive. She was born out of a third-degree consanguineous marriage, and her mother's antenatal period was uneventful. She did not have any significant postnatal NICU admission. Her developmental milestones were normal and obtained according to her age. And immunization, she has been appropriately immunized as per her age. And she has also been immunized with pneumococcal and meningococcal vaccines prior to the splenectomy. She consumes a mixed diet and has normal bowel and bladder habits and has not yet attained menarche. All her other siblings are normal and there's no similar illness in the family. We started the examination after getting informed consent. The patient was conscious, oriented, and equilibrium. The hydration status was fair. She had a hemolytic facies in which there was frontal bossing and parietal and occipital bossing with prominence of the forehead and supraorbital ridges, and there was also a flattened nasal bridge. Pallor was also present. Her sexual maturity was Tanner stage 1. Her vitals were within the normal range. Her height was below -3 standard deviation for age and weight between -2 to -3 standard deviation, but her BMI was between 0 to +1 standard deviation. On abdominal examination, the umbilicus was in midline, flanks free, all quadrants moved equally with respiration, and there was a scar parallel to the left costal margin. There was no visible pulsations or visible peristalsis free. On palpation, the abdomen was not warm and not tender. The liver was not tender and palpable 2.5 cm below the right costal margin. It was firm in consistency with a smooth surface and sharp border. On percussion, there was no free fluid in the abdomen and the liver span was 12.5 cm. On auscultation, normal bouncers were heard. The other system examinations were normal. I'd like to summarize by saying an 11-year-old female child came to hospital with chief complaints of easy fatigability for the past 3 months. She had history of recurrent hospitalizations for the blood transfusion since the 5 months of age, and splenectomy was done at 5 years. She was born out of a third-degree consanguineous marriage. On examination, hemolytic facies was present, pallor was present, and a scar parallel to the left costal margin was present. Liver was palpable 2.5 cm below the right costal margin, and the liver span was 12.5 cm. It's probably a case of thalassemia major, under-transfused, adequately chelated, with HIV-positive status, short stature, and underweight for her age and sex, and with no other complications. I'd like to start investigating by taking complete hemogram with peripheral smear and doing the red blood cell indices and reticulocyte count, serum, iron, and bilirubin levels, fasting and postprandial blood sugars, thyroid function test, and serum calcium. Thank you.
Okay. First of all, you just tell me your professional diagnosis once again.
Yes, ma'am. My professional diagnosis is a case of a thalassemia major, under-transfused, adequately chelated, with HIV-positive status, and undernourished and underbuilt for her age and sex with no other complications.
But he didn't mention about the splenectomy style. He says splenectomy was done, na?
Yes, ma'am.
That should be included in diagnosis.
Yes, ma'am.
That is a major operation he has undergone.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, missed it. You just mentioned with your diagnosis because this is the one of the part of that. Okay. Yes, first, tell me why did you say and how you diagnose the hemolytic anemia? Anemia, okay. How you differentiate hemolytic anemia with other anemia?
Yes, ma'am. First, in the history itself, the patient was saying that she had a disease in which the red cells were bursting, and that was how she described it, ma'am. In the history, she said she was diagnosed with anemia.
No. It came to you. The patient came to you with the diagnosis hemolytic anemia.
Yes.
But I'm asking the patient if it should have occurred in the early, at the very beginning to you.
Yes.
Then how could have you diagnosed the case of hemolytic anemia? What are the features you'll see and you can think it? Could it be a hemolytic anemia? There are some clinical pointers.
Yes, ma'am.
What are those?
Yes, ma'am. Hemolytic anemia. On investigation, we can see that there's a increase.
Before your investigation, on clinical examination.
on clinical examination.
Right? Yes. Anemia means what will you get clinically?
There'll be pallor, ma'am.
Pallor. And if there's a hemolysis, what will you get?
There can be jaundice also, ma'am.
Yes. So if there's a pallor and jaundice and there's no other cause of jaundice or pallor, you can think of hemolytic anemia. And as hemolysis is there, what will be the increased in the body?
Reticulocyte count will be increased.
Yes. No, that is the investigation, but I'm talking the clinical part. I've not gone to the lab. I'm watching the patient in the OPD. So you have seen that baby is having pallor, jaundice. What else? You look for that. Organomegaly.
If there's
hemolysis is going on compensatory RSL hyperplasia, so there will be lymphonephrite, hyperplasia, spinovillas. Okay. So baby had come with the history of a splenectomy in your center.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, I have to ask something about HIV. Do you have any idea about HIV? So, how did he acquire the HIV?
Yes, ma'am. Since she's under recurrent blood transfusions, ma'am, there's a possible... She's under recurrent blood transfusions, ma'am.
So blood transfusion. So, what are the screening we should do before giving the blood transfusion?
HIV screening, HPV and HCV screening, ma'am.
Anything else? Five thing is must to do.
Malaria
and so you said the after before blood transfusion you do the HIV screening. How come he has acquired the HIV?
Yes, ma'am. It could be that the blood was in the window period, ma'am.
Pardon?
If the HIV infection is during in the window period before the onset of antibody
yes.
protection,
okay,
ma'am,
good. It could have been. Okay, so do you know what is the latest policy in HIV? When to treat the child?
Ma'am, as soon as it is diagnosed, ma'am.
Treat all.
Ma'am?
This is the policy, treat all. All the patient HIV positive, we have to treat. There's no criteria, you don't have to delay. And how will you follow up the HIV patients?
Ma'am, regularly they should be checked for compliance of the drugs, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you're doing.
Ma'am, the patient should be regularly checked up for compliance of taking ART, ma'am.
What happens in HIV? What happens in the body? Which cells
CD4.
Are...
Yes, ma'am. CD4 cells.
Yes, so CD4 estimation, regular CD4 estimation.
Yes, ma'am.
And do you have a ART center in your hospital? I
yes,
think
ma'am.
It should be.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so there's a viral load. You do the viral load, HIV viral load testing?
Yes,
you
said,
have you ever gone there?
Yes, ma'am.
So you know what are the things it is there, no? Viral
yes,
load, CD4 testing and all. So you think this is a case of HIV due to blood transfusion?
Most probably, ma'am. Because
okay.
She has no other history, ma'am.
Okay. So did you look for the HIV status of the parents? Ideally, it should be.
Yes, ma'am.
Ideally should be, and in case I'm married or in the adolescent children, if have any exposure, sexual is or sometimes sexual abuse, they have to take that history and the partner should be tested. It's very important.
Sexual abuse was ruled out.
It's 11 years, no? Do you know what are the drugs is given to the for HIV treatment? This the child is on ART?
Oh, ma'am. Recently diagnosed, ma'am.
Recently diagnosed, okay. So... I don't know how much you have read about the HIV because of the big the separate subject, and I think it's not will be very tough for undergraduate. So you tell me something about thalassemia. Why did you say it is a thalassemia?
Yes, ma'am.
What are the factors which lead to you think that this is the case of thalassemia? It could be something in some other hemolytic anemia also.
Yes, ma'am. The patient was apparently normal till 5 months of age, ma'am. Mostly thalassemia will start presenting around 5 to 6 months of age when there's a switch of hemoglobin.
Can you explain why it presents at the 5 to 6 months?
Yes, ma'am. The switch of hemoglobin from hemoglobin F to adult hemoglobin around that age, ma'am.
Okay. And this is a beta thalassemia, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Beta thalassemia. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So adult hemoglobin is constituted by which genes?
Alpha and beta, ma'am.
Beta.
Yes.
How many betas are there? How many alphas in hemoglobin A?
Ma'am, in hemoglobin A, there's two alpha and two beta, ma'am.
Okay. And in fetal hemoglobin, what will be the constituent?
There'll be gamma, two alpha and two gamma, ma'am.
Okay. So there's a defect in the beta chain, and beta chain is responsible for adult hemoglobin, and it starts increasing at the age of 6 months, but there's no beta change, so they present at the 6 months. Okay, then, so if, as a age of presentation, you thought of, and second?
Yes, ma'am, and
in your part, what is the commonest hemolytic anemia in your part? Because it varies with the region to region.
Yes, ma'am.
If you go in the southern part, or if you go in the eastern part in Jharkhand, Bihar, there is sickle cell anemia. If you go in the eastern part in West Bengal, in northern part, in Jammu Kashmir part, you will get thalassemia. Yes. So it depends upon the incidence. So it is common incidence. Thalassemia is the commonest one among the all other hemolytic. Yes, what are the other type of hemolytic anemias you know?
Sickle cell anemia.
And?
Spirocytosis, ma'am. Hereditary spirocytosis.
Okay, what else? These are all hemoglobinopathies. Other than that?
And then enzyme defects, ma'am. G6PD deficiency.
Very good.
Okay. Pyruvate kinase deficiency, ma'am.
So enzyme deficiency, cell wall deficiency, and hemoglobinopathies all lead to hemolytic anemia. So how do you treat? This patient has already gone for the surgery and it has gone too far. But how do you treat the thalassemia? Other than split, what are the other mode of therapies are available?
Yes, ma'am.
As of written in your slides.
Yes, ma'am. We have to start with blood transfusions, ma'am.
What is the criteria of blood transfusion? When to transfuse the blood? What should be the hemoglobin level?
Hemoglobin less than 7-6, ma'am.
Sorry. You know, there's a super transfusion, hyper transfusion.
Yes, ma'am. Low transfusion maintains hemoglobin around 8 to 10, ma'am. Hyper transfusion.
Pre-transfusional hemoglobin or post-transfusional hemoglobin you're talking about?
Pre-transfusional hemoglobin.
So you're allowing the baby to be hypoxic? If you're giving the transfusion when baby becomes anemic, at 6, that means there will be hypoxia?
Yes, ma'am.
So you are allowing the baby, ideally should be yes. And why there is this facial changes?
Due to the extra medullary hematopoiesis, ma'am. There's expansion of the medulla of the
Why there is extra medullary hematopoiesis?
Ma'am, because there's excessive of hemolysis, the bone marrow starts to expand, ma'am.
Okay. So why there's
erythropoietin?
Can you explain why there's excessive of hemolysis?
Yes, ma'am. The beta, since there's deficiency of beta globulins, there'll be clumps formed in the RBCs, ma'am.
What makes the clumps? Beta is not there.
Alpha will make the clumps.
Yes,
ma'am.
For tetramerization. Then what will happen?
And that will cause abnormalities in the RBCs, ma'am, which will be detected by the spleen, and it will be removed easier, faster.
Okay, so now tell me the complications of blood transfusions.
Blood transfusion, major complication is acutely we can have a rejection, ma'am, and it can be a hypersensitivity reaction, ma'am.
Yes.
When that will give porphyrinamine and paracetamol, ma'am.
And what are the complication could be there if after
blood iron transfusion? Overload can be there, ma'am.
For iron overload, repeated transfusion.
Yes.
So what are the organs will be involved in iron overload?
Yes, all the endocrine organs such as thyroid, pancreas.
Okay. Only endocrine?
And ovary, in case of females, ma'am, reproductive organs. And even heart will be affected, ma'am.
Yes. They die of thalassemia child if you don't go for the surgery. And
yes,
they die of?
They have a...
What is the commonest cause of death in non-poorly chelated patients?
Ma'am?
What is the commonest cause of death in case of poorly chelated patient of thalassemia?
Iron overload causing cardiomyopathy, ma'am.
Yes, rest and heart failure. I have written the chelating agent, that is, I think, desferrexamine or deferiprone or desirox.
Deferiprone.
Okay, so what are the iron chelators are there? Can you name them?
Yes, ma'am. Deferrioxime is given subcutaneously as a continuous infusion, ma'am, for around 8 hours daily, around for 5 to 6 days a week, ma'am.
So it is injectable. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. And oral is deferiprone, ma'am, which is given mixed with water, around 75 mg per kg, ma'am.
And anything else deferiprone? After that, deferiprone is quite old drug. There's a new drug. That drug also very old, desirox, deferasirox.
Yes.
That is usually given nowadays. Huh? Okay, I think it's enough for you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vinay.
Sorry for the technical difficulties.
No. Thank you, Vinay.
Thank you,
Mrinalini. I would now request our respected judge, Dr. Professor Kalpana Datta ma'am, to comment on the overall performance of all the participants and also share her experience with us.
Yes. Thank you, Ashmita. It's a wonderful experience to interact with the young generations, and you feel young when you are with the young people. And they have prepared very nicely. They have gone through the cases very nicely. I'm really happy that they have gone through the cases very and prepared very nicely. And it's a wonderful experience to have all those discussion with these different regions. I'm very happy that everyone is same way what we see in our West Bengal. We are seeing in the from Jipmer, from the Mrinalini, from, I think, from South. No, she's from South. So we are getting different corners of the students and having same experience. And I think you should have this type of conferences every year. And you include many, many students for the presentation of cases, I think.
Yes, so ma'am. Actually, this is the second edition of SAMHSAcon. We had its first edition last year and we had participants more than 600 from all over the nation. So this time also we had offline event. We planned everything offline only, but due to COVID-19 pandemic, we had to shift it.
Yes, that is the unprecedented and unexpected situation we have. We are facing, everyone is facing the pandemic. So it's a nice experience and I wish you all for your future. You will be a very good doctor and you will rise and you will establish in your own places wherever you are. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for being the judge at our event. And now I would like to conclude this event. Acha, before going, I would like to request all the participants to switch on their camera once so that we can take a screenshot. Everyone, please start your camera once. Ayush, just take a screenshot.
Yeah, I'm doing it. Ekna, ma'am. Is she there? Okay, say cheese. Okay. Yeah, it's done.
Thank you all the participants and respected ma'am. And the results will be announced on 11th of October at 7 p.m. at our valedictory ceremony.
Thank you, ma'am.
Should I end it?
Yes, I should end the program.